Welcome students to the class of design of steel structures. Today we are going to see the design of gantry girder. I am Mr. Sissogule, assistant professor civil engineering. Basically, what is gantry girder? So here you can see in the industry or the industrial shed, the look is somewhat like this. This is the typical look of the industrial shed. And in this industry, most of the times the crane has been kept to move the material from here, from one place to another place. So what will happen to support that crane? There must be some arrangement. So to support this crane, there must be a crane girder. So this is a crane girder. This yellow thing is the crane girder, and the crane girder has to support on something. So on which this crane girder has been supported, that is this beam. Particularly, this is the rail, and below that is rail is supported by the beam, and that beam is called as a gantry girder. So basically, this is the gantry girder on which the crane girder lies, and on that crane girder the girder moves. So this way you can deliver the material from at any place in the particular that shed. So this is particularly the gantry girder. Now, what are the components of this overhead crane? So here you can see, this is particularly the gantry girder. This is the span of this crane girder. Here you can see, this is the crane girder. These are the wheel center. This is the crab or the crane or the trolley, and hook has been suspended over here, which used to lift this any material. And this particular crane is moving from this direction to this direction on this crane girder. It's on this direction. So actually, there may be some distance up to which it will go. So suppose it is go up to this position. So this is the minimum approach of the crane. So this distance is the minimum approach of this particular crane. So here you can see, from here to here, this is the minimum approach. So up to which distance that crane goes on this crane girder. And this crane girder, those having two wheels, that is moving on the gantry girder. So again, you can see, this is particularly the gantry girder. Here you can see, this is the gantry girder. Typical drawing is here. These are the gantry girders, and above that black color is the particularly rail on which this crane girder or crane truss slides. And this is the crab, and this is particularly the top view. So now, what are the loads coming on this particular gantry girder? One more thing I would like to add, this crane is either manually operated, or the that is hand operated, or the electrically operated overhead traveling crane. So that is the case, and depending on which the this load on the particular this crane has been added, based on it, whether it is electrically operated or the manually operated. So gantry girder are laterally supported beams subjected to impact loads. The gantry girder undergoes unsymmetrical bending due to forces. That is, first is the reaction from this crane girder. So these are the reactions you can see. These are the reaction, that is wheel load mentioned over here. Then, which are acting vertically. Then the longitudinal thrust due to starting and stopping of the crane. So here you can see, due to this starting and braking, here you can see this longitudinal thrust is there on this particular crane. And third thing is lateral thrust. This is because of this crab, because of the starting and stop of the crab. So this way, these three loads are coming. That is, one is vertical, another is longitudinal in this direction due to crane girder, and third is the lateral thrust. That is because of the moving of the crab or the crane. So here you can see clearly, these are the vertical loads which is due to the wheels of this crane girder. Then the longitudinal thrust, that is because of the moving of this crane girder. And third is the lateral or horizontal load, that is because of the moving of the crab on the crane girder. So these three types of loads are there on the gantry girder. Now the loads, that is vertical loads, are acting over the gantry girder is the reaction from the crane girder and consists of the self weight of the crane. That is, we are describing the vertical loads. Self weight of the crane, self weight of the crab, and crane capacity, that is maximum load that can be hoisted by the crane. To calculate this, the reaction, the maximum wheel load is computed, and it occurs when the crab is nearest to the gantry girder. So if suppose this crab is nearest to the gantry girder, then the maximum load will be there on the gantry girder. In addition to the reaction from the gantry crane girder, the self weight of the rail should be considered. So basically we have seen this crane is the rail is there, so we have to consider this load of the rails also. Now the lateral loads, these are caused due to sudden, as we have discussed already, these are caused due to sudden stopping and starting of the crab, that is this way on this direction. This will act in this direction, in this direction. Then the longitudinal loads are caused due to stopping as or starting of the crane girder and produce the thrust along the rails. The lateral and longitudinal thrust are transferred at the rail level. Remember that lateral and longitudinal thrust are transferred at the rail level. Therefore, the gantry girder are also subjected to bending movement due to these loads. The stresses produced in the gantry girder due to these loads are more than those caused by the gradually applied load. This is to cover the forces set up by sudden application of the brakes to rapidly moving loaded crane acceleration, retardation, vibration, possible slips of slings, etc. To account this, the suitable impact factor are introduced and when it is applicable. So as per IS 875, the additional loads are given below, that is in this particular table. So you can see the vertical forces transfers to the wheel. For electrically operated cranes, you have to take the 25% of the maximum static wheel load, that is additional load. For hand operated cranes, we have to take 10% of maximum static wheel load. Then in case of this horizontal forces transfers to the rail, for electrically operated cranes, we have to take the 10% of the weight of the crab and weight of the weight that is lifted by the crane. And for hand operated, that is manually operated, we have to take 5% of the weight of the crab and the load lifted by the crane. And the horizontal, in case of this horizontal forces along the rail, the 5% of static loads for electrically or hand operated cranes. So these additional loads we have to consider in account of the impact. Now, what are the specifications for the gantry girder? So first, a gantry girder section is subjected to vertical and horizontal thrust simultaneously. Therefore, the allowable stresses are increased by 10%. This increase in allowable stresses is not addition to that allowed for the erection loads with or without wind or seismic forces. So what you have to do, we have to increase the allowable stresses by 10%. But remember, this increase in allowable stresses is not in addition that allowed for the erection or with or without wind or the seismic forces. So we have to keep this thing in mind. Then either two of the horizontal forces specified in earlier table, that is table, this table, should be considered to act along with the vertical load at a time. So either one of these two forces, that is either this horizontal force transfers to the rail or horizontal force along the rail, So either of these two forces we have to consider with vertical load. So either longitudinal load or transverse load, that we have to consider with the vertical load. Both loads are not acting simultaneously on the particular gantry girder at a time. So that we need to consider. Then the vertical deflection of the gantry girder should not exceed the values specified below. The first, where the crane is manually operated, this limit is L by 500. Where the cranes are traveling overhead and operated electrically up to 500 kN, so the deflection is L by 750. And where cranes are traveling overhead and operated electrically over 500 kN, so that is the deflection limit again L by 1000. And for other moving loads such as charging cars, etc., that thing is L by 600. So here you can see we have the different conditions for the different capacities and the type of operation of the crane. So these things we need to consider, and where this L is the span of the gantry girder. So these vertical deflections of the gantry girder we have to consider. So where the load is more, the deflection is allowance in deflection is obviously less. Here the 50 ton is there, and here more than 50 ton is there. So according to that, the things has been shown over here. Now these are the some profiles which has been used while preparing or providing the gantry girder. So here you can see only I section has been provided as a gantry girder, and rail is over this thing. Then I plus channel has been provided. Sometimes I plus angle has been provided. This is the gantry truss that is using I cords is there. This is the web members, and this is the I sections for the heavy loads has been, this thing has been made. Then this is the plate girder, that is by using plates the gantry girder has been developed. And this is by using channel and plates the gantry girder has been developed. So these are some profiles which has been used while designing the gantry girder. Then design of the gantry girder. The gantry girder is designed as follows. To find the maximum wheel load, this load is maximum when the crab is closest to the gantry girder. This distance is minimum approach of the crane hook to the gantry girder. As I told you earlier, when we will get the maximum load on the particular gantry, when this particular this crab is at nearest to the gantry girder, then we will get the maximum load on these two wheels, and obviously those two wheels will transferring the load to the this gantry girder. So that's why we will get the maximum load at that condition. The crab in a such position on the crane girder gives the maximum reaction on the gantry girder. The vertical reaction on the crane girder transfers through the two wheels on the gantry girder. Therefore the maximum wheel load is half of the reaction. So it is transferring by in the two wheels, so that's why it is maximum wheel load is half of that particular reaction. The maximum wheel load is increased for an impact as specified in this last slide, that is in this table. We have to increase. Then the maximum bending moment. The maximum bending moment in gantry girder due to vertical load is computed. This consists of the bending moment due to above found max wheel load, maximum wheel load with impact, and bending moment due to self weight of the girder and the rail. So remember the condition. Suppose this is the gantry girder and this is the wheels of two crane girders. So when we will get the maximum bending moment? We will get the maximum bending moment when this crane girder will be in this position. That is, it is that this is the B is the wheelbase of this particular crane. So the this wheel should be at B by 4. Wheel should be at B by 4 from the center of the gantry girder. So remember, the B is the wheelbase, L is the span. So this the wheels are should be at B by 4 from this particular middle of the span, then we will get the maximum bending moment. So this is the condition for the maximum bending moment. So we have to keep this thing in mind while solving problem. Again, we are going to this thing, but you have to keep this thing in mind that when we will get the maximum bending moment, that is the wheel of the crane girder should be at B by 4. B is nothing but the wheel base of the particular crane girder, and that is also from the midpoint of the this gantry girder. Now the maximum shear force is computed. This consists of the shear force due to wheel load and dead load from the gantry girder and rails. The shear due to the wheel load is maximum when one of the wheel is at support if only one crane is running over the girder. So when the shear force will be maximum, so one of the this is this condition that one of the wheel should be on one support. So at this time the shear force will be maximum on this particular gantry girder. Now the section modulus of the gantry girder is found by equation, as we know, it is bending equation, Z equals to M divided by sigma BC or T, where M is the maximum bending moment due to vertical loads, sigma BC or T is the permissible bending stress, that is 0.665. We have already seen in the design of beams. A suitable section is chosen from the IS handbook or the steel table. Generally, an IS section with a channel is provided, as we have seen in the profiles. As the gantry girder are laterally unsupported, the trial section modulus is provided, that is I section with the channel section on the compression flange, is usually 20 to 40% more than the calculated sectional modulus. So you have to provide the more section modulus, that is 20 to 40% more, as we have calculated in this particular equation. So generally the economic depth of the gantry girder is not less than 1/12 of the span, except when the loads are small in relation to the span. The width of the flange should be between 1/40 to 1/30 of the span to prevent the excessive lateral deflection. So these things you have to keep in mind while solving problem, we will see in details. Now to calculate the moment of inertia of the girder section about the both the axis, the maximum bending stress in compression and in tension is calculated by the following equation, that is by using this equation. This is for the compression and this is for the tension, where y1 and y2 are the distances of the extreme fibers of the compression and tension flange from the neutral axis respectively. Because we are sometimes, or as suggested, we are providing the member like this, we will see in detail. We are preferring the member like this. So obviously in this case it is symmetrical section, so obviously this distance from this top fiber, that is compression fiber, and this tension fiber will be the same. But in this case this is not the case. Obviously the CG will move somewhat upwards because we are adding the channel section over here. So obviously this distance and this distance is different. So this is y1 over here, that is compression, and this is y2. So this is the condition that how we are calculating this stresses at compression and tension flanges. So the bending stress in tension should less than the permissible bending stress, that is 1.1 into 0.66 Fy. Why 1.1? Because we are adding this thing by 10%. That's why it is 1.1. Now the lateral forces on the gantry girder and the maximum bending moment and shear due to these are calculated. The position of the wheels should be same as step number 2 and 3. So again we have to calculate that the lateral forces and the wheels should be like this and this. This is for the step 2 and this is for the step 3. So same thing we have to keep. Then the maximum compressive stress due to lateral loads is calculated. The compression flange is assumed to take a lateral loads Hence, the moment of inertia of the compression flange required about its YY axis is calculated. So, the maximum compressive stress due to lateral load is calculated, and the compression flange is taking that load, that is this upper portion. This upper portion is taking that load that we are assuming. Then, the moment of inertia of the compression flange required about its YY axis is calculated. So, this is actually XX axis. And this is YY axis. So, that's why. And load is coming from this direction. So, that's why we are calculating the YY axis moment of inertia and taking the check. The total bending compressive stress is found by adding the bending stresses, that is calculated in step number 5, that is this one, and this step, that is this step. It should not exceed the allowable bending compressive stress. So both the additions should not exceed that allowable stress. The allowable bending compressive stress is calculated and is increased by 10%. So as we have seen earlier, again it is increased by 10%. The longitudinal forces along the rails and the stresses, that is direct and bending, in the longitudinal direction are calculated. Again, these longitudinal forces are calculated. Then the connections by using rivet, that is we have to connect this channel to the I section, so that connection we have to make. So again, that is there, but in this particular unit we are not going to in depth of this thing. And the maximum shear stress in gantry girder is checked. So these are the steps for the gantry girder, and this is all about the design of the gantry girder. So in coming lectures we are going to see how to solve the problem on the gantry. References for today's lecture is Design of Steel Structure by SK Duggal and slideshare.net. Thank you.